Good morning. My name is Mabel Forsyth. My chief name is Timberwolf, and I'm from the Dimdan clan. And this town sits on our traditional territory. We're called Kasia, means grizzly house. And hereditary chief was Frank Alec is our house chief. And he works away from home, away from us, so he's not able to be with us at every function. So I'm representing Hereditary Chief Was Frank Alec, and I welcome you to our traditional territory, Kasia. I welcome you. Thank you.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Taylor Backrack. I'm the Member of Parliament for Skeena Bulkley Valley, and I'm so pleased to bring a warm welcome to the Smithers Multicultural event, the first annual Smithers Multicultural event, an opportunity to celebrate all of the diverse cultures that are represented here in our community. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me down to the beautiful old church this morning on Wet'suwet'en traditional territory to bring this welcome. And I wanted to speak for a quick moment about the importance of celebrating multiculturalism here in our community. I was talking to someone just recently who grew up in Smithers and has been here for a lot of years, and they were saying how they don't think that our community has ever been as diverse as it is now. You walk down Main Street and you see people from all cultures, all different parts of the world, and they're all Smithereens. They're all calling this place home, and it's so wonderful to celebrate that diversity with events like this. I was also thinking back to several years ago when I got to attend a citizenship ceremony here in Smithers, and seeing people from so many diverse backgrounds come together and reflect on what it means to be here in Canada, what it means to celebrate multiculturalism, which, as many of you know, is a very unique approach as a country. It's not an approach that every country has taken. And I think we should take every day, take as many days as we can to look around us, to make people feel welcome, to celebrate the food and the dance and all the cultural expression that people bring to our community from all over the world. I was looking at the program, and there's an incredible lineup of talent that you're going to get to enjoy at this event. So I'll leave it there. It's a real honor to be here, and I hope you enjoy the show. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. It's my pleasure to be here to help welcome people to this first Smithers Multicultural event. My name is Gladys Attrell, and I have the privilege of being mayor with Smithers Town Council. So on behalf of council and the residents of Smithers, we say congratulations to the organizers of this event and really want to think about the special energy that people from other parts of the world bring to our community. We are richer for it to share in the dance, the music, the songs, and the food that other people bring to this valley. So I say thank you to the people who have come to make this home, and again to the organizers of this event. I wish you all the best, and I look forward to seeing it, and to the ones that come later in the future. Thank you.
Hadi, my name is Mal Basil, and I belong to the Gixan and Wet'suwet'en peoples. And I'm a storyteller, a drummer and singer, and an activist and a counselor. Also a father, a family man, and I just love life. I'm pleased to present a story as well as a second story. And I was going to sing a song, but lately our protocols call me not to. So I will sing a song when our community is free to pick up our drums again. There's two stories I would like to tell. There is one called The Kind Trapper, and it's a winter story. The second story I would like to tell is a story of Misty. And Misty was a giant owl. And the second story is a Kadete legend. That means it's a very ancient legend. Our people do not remember the length of time because we do not measure our time in a line. it is not linear measure, it is a circle. And so that means history will always repeat itself. And in linear time, we would know how many hundreds of years back this story occurred. But in our measure, it's ongoing. So before I tell stories, I first would like to invite you to close your eyes and picture a ball of saliva on your tongue and allow yourself to swallow it and picture it going down your throat and into your stomach. And inside your stomach, you can see the light shining through. And now it's dissipating into your body and also becoming light. I would also like you to picture that everything around you is the color white. Everything around you is white like snow. It is now changing to the color red like the sunrise. Everything around is red. Now it is changing to the color yellow. Everything around you is yellow, now changing to the color blue. Everything is blue like the sky, and you may open your eyes. I am now holding your imaginations. So I will borrow your imagination and then I will hand it back to you. At the end of the stories, we'll go through the same process and your imaginations will be returned to you. The story of the kind trapper is a time in the winter time. And in our ancient times, our people lived in the village of Witsetwitni or other villages like Netachban or Hagwaget. And in our summer times, that's when we lived in the villages. In the winter times, we lived in our winter homes in all of the different territories that were far from the villages. And we would hunt or trap or fish. And we would collect a lot of these goods and we would prepare them for trading, for feasting. We prepared them for our own use and storage. And in the wintertime, we were separated as families in all these different territories in pit houses. They were either beside lakes or on ridges, and they housed small families or individuals. And the pit house was a near perfect system where in the summer, they were very cool inside without any energy. And in the wintertime, they were very warm inside with very little energy. The pit house that this man owned was right beside the lake. And he was out hunting and trapping for quite a while. And he was beginning to get lonely because he was there for so many weeks without visits or without people. But also, it was very silent everywhere because he didn't see any movement of animals. And so every day he went to go check his traps. And his traps were made out of a deadfall tree. He would remove the branches and it would be able to slide up and down on the tree branches that he leaned against the tree. And that deadfall, it was heavy enough if it dropped onto an animal, it would instantly kill the animal. And the trapper, whenever he went to go check his traps, there was nothing in the traps. There was no animals moving at this lake. And when he checked his traps, he also noticed that there was no tracks anywhere. And so he was beginning to become very lonely. And it was a few more weeks maybe a month and a half before another guest was going to come and visit him. In the summertime, when our people were feasting back in the village, that was when they would prearrange when they would come and visit in the wintertime. And they had those protocols in the feasts because that's where our business resides. That's where our governance of our lands exists. And in the feasts, they would predetermine that they would come and visit in the wintertime at a certain time. And they knew when they would expect a visit. And this was good for each other's mental health because the solitude was not healthy if you were alone for too long. And checking up on each other, making sure they're safe, because also the territory is treacherous in the winter. and moving with all the territory having landslides or anything else, you would want to make sure that your friends are okay. So he was getting lonely and he went back after checking his traps. And every day he did this on time. In the morning, the first thing he did is have water, get ready and go check his traps and come back and have breakfast and relax for a bit. He did this often. And his loneliness was building. But after one day, he was finishing some breakfast by the lake, by the fire. And he's enjoying the view of the lake in the wintertime. And then all of a sudden, he could hear at the end of the lake some footsteps. And so he got up. He was excited. He got up and stood up and looked. And as he looked, he could see a pack of wolves running across the lake. The frozen lake was a trail they were making across the lake to the other end of it. And he watched all of these wolves run across the lake. The last wolf kept stopping, and he would lift up his paw onto his jaw right here. And then he would keep running and catch up again to all the other wolves. And they didn't wait for him. They just kept going their speed, but he had to run extra hard to catch up to them. And then once in a while, stop and try to comfort his jaw. Something was bothering his jaw. And as he ran in front of the cabin, he stopped. And when he was lifting up his paw to comfort his mouth again, he turned and looked, and there was that trapper. And the trapper was watching him and smiling. And the wolf kept catching up to the rest of his pack. As the man sat down, his heart was beating very wonderfully. He was so happy and overjoyed because for the first time in a long time, he saw some life. And he felt that that was like a visit, especially the one wolf that stopped and looked at him. And so he was comforted and happy. And he began to get ready to clean up his breakfast, and he was going to go back to the trail and look at his traps again. The next morning, he went to check his traps, and he came back and he was about to prepare some meal. But he heard noises behind his pit house. He got up and he thought, this is another visit. And he turned and looked around the cabin. And he could see a group of men. And this group of men, they were all wearing headdresses that were made from the skins of the wolf. And they all had a headdress with wolves on them. And he didn't recognize the way they looked. They looked very different. They kept pushing one of the men forward. And he was holding his mouth. And he looked very, very tired and he looked really uncomfortable and a lot of great pain. And they pushed him gently forward, and he was shy, but he walked forward. And he stepped in front of that man, and that man asked him if he can look inside his mouth. And so he let go. And when he asked for permission to look inside, he opened it up as best he could. And inside, in his mouth, he could see there was a broken piece of bone from a caribou. And it was broken through his gum. And it was really infected and swollen. And it was causing great pain in this man. And so he invited him to have a seat by the fire. And he went into his house, into his pit house. And he pulled out a pouch that he wore on his side. And this pouch held inside items that trappers need. One of the items was a tweezer. And he went to underneath a tree by the lake, and he dug underneath the snow. And he pulled up some medicines from some of the plants. And he put them all inside his mouth, and he was chewing them. And he took the tweezers, and he walked back to that man, and he asked him again if he could look inside his mouth again. And when he opened his mouth, it wasn't wide enough to fit his tweezer in. So he had to hold that man's face and put the tweezer right on the bone and firmly hold it. And when he pulled it out, he placed it beside and pulled out the medicine. And he put it in his mouth by the wound. And he closed that man's mouth and picked up his hand and he gently put it back on his jaw. And that man was holding his jaw. And after a few minutes, he could see him settling down. But then his eyes lit up and he looked back at the trapper and he nodded and he could let go of his mouth. The medicine soothed the wound and took down the swelling and began to treat the infection. The trapper then cleaned up and that man got back up. He no longer needed to hold his mouth and he nodded at the trapper. They didn't speak. Any of the men spoke and they all walked behind the pit house again and waved. But that trapper was trying to get them to join him for food and to visit a little longer. He said he would really love to talk and love to get to know who they were. And so the men refused. They just kept waving and walking away. And that last man that he helped, he waved and turned, and they all left into the darkness in the forest. That man, that trapper, sat down and began thinking about what happened there. And he was really happy he could help that man. And even though they didn't stay for food, he was really thankful that they came to see him. And he put away a lot of his mess and he went back to check his traps. And again, same thing. There was nothing in the traps. So he went home, back to bed for the early morning. The next morning, immediately, same thing. Drink some water, get dressed really well, go outside and back to the trail again. This time when he went to check his traps, each one of the traps, still, they were not sprung. But laying beside each trap was an animal, a small animal with its life taken, and he would collect them. And he checked every trap, and each one was the same. They were unsprung, but there was an animal laying beside them. And he kept doing this each day. He was so overjoyed. He had a lot of work to do, and he had the best luck again. And he was happy. He was doing a lot of work. And this went on for days. And each time I went to check his traps, again, same thing. They were laying beside. And none of the traps were sprung. What I mean by sprung is there's a, when the tree has its branches removed and they lean it against another tree, they then use the branches they cut off to make a little cabin at the bottom of the deadfall. And they make a roof. And they tie a string to some bait. And they put another twig in the ground so that that bait line will go around the twig. And it's attached to another twig that's holding the deadfall up. When the animal goes into the little house and pulls on the bait, he frees that stick holding up the deadfall, and the deadfall falls onto the animal. But none of these traps were sprung this way. All these days went by and he had a lot of wealth. So one morning while he was cleaning some of the animals' furs, he stopped because he could hear at the end of this lake at this end now. And this time the wolves were running the other direction back where they were coming from. They must have been done their hunt. But the last wolf this time, he recognized him. He didn't have to stop running to paw at his jaw anymore. He kept up with all of the wolves all the way, but he did stop right in front of his cabin. And this time he looked at the cabin. He did not have to touch his jaw, but he raised his paw and waved at the man. He waved at the trapper, and then he caught up to his pack and they all ran out of sight. And so that man, that trapper, what he witnessed was a very beautiful sight of these wolves and their kindness, and his kindness was very, very present. And that's the story of the kind trapper. So the second story I would like to tell is from ancient times. It is not in our memory how far back this happened. Long before colonization and the roads and the railways, power lines, airplanes, everybody walked on foot for fish, trade. We did warfare. Or traveling to other villages for marriages or feasts. Everything we did was on foot. In this time, when you're out on the move, there's a certain time when the children were told to be home and inside, and that was when it became dark. It was known by all the children to be home and inside the house before dark fell. It was in our tradition and in our laws that the children must be inside the house and they don't live in the darkness. And it was also taught to the children that you must listen to your adults in your family, your elders, your parents. And if you don't listen, it was warned, if you don't listen, the owl, Misti, is going to come and take you away. And that did happen in past. There was a giant owl in that time. And this big, big owl was big enough to take a child. And they called him Misti. Misti was known as a very large owl. And he lived not far from the village. And this chief in Witsetwitni is now known as Witset. Witsetwitni at the canyon, there was a chief fishing, and all the people were still fishing, and it was becoming dark, and his children were playing. The family members that were watching him, they said, it's time to come inside, it's getting dark, we're going to go to bed. But his son, this chief's son, would not listen. And so as he was warned, they told him, if you do not listen, the owl will come and take you away. And the child would not listen. He was challenging them. And sure enough, the Misti, the big owl, came flying to the canyon right by the longhouses and began circling and flew down and took this chief's son. And he flew him up towards the mountain. And when the chief was finished fishing and he came back, and he asked where his son was because he saw that everybody was in bed but his son. And the elders and the people came in the house and told him, your son would not listen. And we warned him many times that the owl, Misti, was going to come and take him. And that is what happened. They flew him up the hill. And so the father put his tools away and he went up the hill to capture his son. But he needed help. He didn't know where to go. Nobody in the village knew where Misti lived. So this man, he walked up to the trail and he stopped where there were grouse. And there was a bullhen of the grouse. And he talked to her. And he said, I need your help. Misti has taken my son. They flew up this way. Do you know which way they went or where he lives? And that bullhen studied this man. He studied this father, and he looked him down, up and down, and he said to him, you look like a kind man. You look like a good man. I want to help you. I want eyebrows. I do not have eyebrows. I want pretty red eyebrows. And so that man walked up to a spruce tree, and he dug a hole down to the bottom roots. And he pulled out the soft tip of the roots. And when he broke it, red coloring was coming out. And he knelt down. And he painted the red coloring onto the grouse's face above his eyes and gave him red eyebrows. And so that bull hen walked up to the lake, or to the creek, and looked into the creek to admire her eyebrows. Was very happy with her eyebrows. And she told him, "I like my eyebrows. I thank you. I will help you. You're on the right trail. Keep following this trail to the top. When you arrive to the water, do not look up at the trees for the nest of Misti. Look to the water. When you look to the water, you will see the nest." And so that father continued up the trail. And as he continued up the trail, he got to the top. And just like he was told, he refused to look up at the treetops. He looked in the water. And as he walked along the lake's edge, he could look to the water. And in the reflection, he could see one top of the trees had a nest. And so he entered that world and climbed that tree. Up to halfway, he stopped because he could hear the wings of the Misti flying to the nest. And he froze. And the owl, Misti, landed in his nest. And he had a mouthful of rodents, food for the baby. He was coming to feed his baby. And he knelt down and dropped the food in front of his baby. And he told them, "Kluk, Anna." He told his baby to eat. And the baby refused to eat. Didn't have any interest in the rodents. And so Misti was concerned and went to go hunt for some more food for his baby. His baby was hungry. And when he flew away, the father continued up the tree. And as he continued up the tree, he was able to stop at the top and collect his son. And he instructed his son to hold him tight because he had to climb back down the tree. And as he got to the bottom and they left that world, they went down the trail back to the village of Witsetwitney. And he went to his longhouse and he placed his son to bed. And he talked with his elders really quickly and he went back outside. When he went back to the canyon, he could see the Misti kind of walking around, batting his wings at his hips, and he looked concerned. He's walking around, singing a song. "Mukhek, mukhek," he's singing, calling to his baby. And he was telling the parents, "I'm watching over your baby for you." And the chief walked up to him and told him, "I have my son now. He's my son. But I will make you a deal." He said, "I'm going to make a bridge for you." And he took these hollow plants that were dried, and the plants were hollow, and he could connect the ends to them together. And he made a bridge across the river, Witsinqua. He put this bridge across the river, made out of these dried plants. And he told Misti, "I would like you to sing that same song you were singing when I first got here. And I want you to dance across the river on this bridge I made for you. In the middle, I want you to do an extra move where you jump up a little higher. And if you do not go into the water and you get to the other side of this river, you can come and take my son. But if you wind up in the river and we have to rescue you and dry you off, then you will not take our children ever again." And that Misti agreed. He went up to that bridge that man made for him, and he began to dance across and singing his song And just like he was agreed, in the middle of the river, he did that extra jump. And when he landed on the bridge again, it broke. And he wound up in the water. And the people downstream, they fished him out. And they fished him out. And that chief, the father, he had a nestick, a blanket. And he opened it up and he wrapped Misty with it. And he began to dry off his feathers all over his body. He's drying him off. And that owl held up his wing and he said, "My armpit, my other armpit." And he held up his belly, "Blood, my belly," because there was still water underneath. The deal was he had to be completely dry. And he turned around and he held out his boot. He said, "My boot." And he had to dry off his boot, his bum. And he lifted up his feet, the last pieces that were still wet underneath his feet. And that chief dried off all of the owl. And the owl agreed he will not take the children again. That father said, "There you go, just like we agreed. You're nice and dry now. You cannot take our children again." And since then, the Misti has not taken the children from Witset. And that is the story of Misti. It's an ancient story. It was told to me by my late grandmother, Gohet. My late grandmother told me this story since I was 4. It is among my favorites. So thank you for having me. I appreciate the Smithers Multicultural Society for having us all present and to record in this fashion so everybody can enjoy this at home. And I hope that when we get a chance to meet again, that we can tell this story in person and enjoy each other's company again. So snikhalia to all the organizers and to all of you for listening. As agreed, we borrowed your imaginations. So now that the stories are over, I will now return your imaginations to you. So I invite you again to close your eyes. And picture that everything around you is blue like the sky. Everything is blue, now changing to the color yellow. Like yellow snow. Don't eat it. It's all changing yellow to red. Everything is red like the sunrise. Now it's changing back to the color white. White like snow. You can eat that snow. You can open your eyes. Thank you again. Snikhalia.
Hello, my name is Joanna, and this is JJ, or Jordan, and this is Sarah, and this is Katie, and they're going to be performing a dance. It's called the Scottish Highland Fling. So my family's Scottish, so these kids are actually half Scottish, half Chinese, and the dance is done with the bagpipes. It's a very old dance, originally probably Celtic or Gaelic origin, and it would have been men that would have done these dances, and they would have danced to pick the best men for battle. But now it's men and women that do the dances, and it would have been done in the north of Scotland, in the Highlands, so no better place than the Bulkley Valley to do that. So JJ and I are gonna take a bow here. Put your hand on your hips, you ready? We're gonna smile and bow. Good job.
Thank you. I'm Mark, this is Kiri. I'm going to play a song about a bicycle for you. Well, a pedal comes up when you push a pedal down, and a bicycle wheel goes spinning around. Hey, it's a good way to move. And it's a simple principle that's been working for years, and I can feel the wind whistle by my ears. This must be freedom. Bicycles cover ground, and bicycles are a good way to get around. Hey, look at that kid, he's going for broke. He's got a baseball card stuck in his spokes. He's making noise, and his wheels are turning. And it feels pretty good to be gone like that when life's biggest worry is a flat tire. Bicycles cover ground, and bicycles are a good way to get around. In Montreal, we rode the old canal, all those run-down buildings with stories to tell. Not back home, and I'm on a dirt road, and for a second or two, I'm 10 years old, and I'm moving right along. Hey, I'm moving right along on my bicycle. Hey, bicycles cover ground, and bicycles are a good way to get around. Hey, a pedal comes up when you push a pedal down, and a bicycle wheel goes spinning around. This must be freedom. Okay, Curie and I are going to do a song. It's called Golden Spruce. And about 1997, a guy named Grant Hayden up in Haida Gwaii, he cut down a 300-year-old tree, which is it's kind of a celebrated tree. And the interesting part of the story is he did it, basically he was upset at how much logging was going on, and he didn't know what to do, so he cut down a historical valued tree to a lot of people. And anyways, shortly after that, he disappeared. And they found pieces of his kayak. So I read this book, and I started thinking about that. And that's where this song came from. It's called Golden Spruce. He's gone. Where did he go? Out on the North Pacific. There's places we'll never know. They found pieces of his kayak washed up on the shore. Say if anyone could have survived, he'd done it before. He cut down that golden spruce, a legend fell and the earth shook. Said, now these trees have your attention. I did what it took. And the ghost of a Haida paddler, they talk about the old ways. Before the Spanish and the smallpox and the price they paid. The golden spruce grew tall. He said we're part of something here, not the driving force. We need to find our place, let nature run its course. One golden spruce tree falls, everybody sees and hears, but nobody seems to notice when a whole forest disappears. And the ghost of a Haida paddler, they talk about the old ways. Before the Spanish and the smallpox, and the price they paid, and the gold. Now there are rumors that he ran off to Russia, where he was seen in some Alaskan bar. Young men drinking beer in a Rupert Hotel say he never would have made it that far. And some hiders say that tree could trick your mind. And people die out here searching for what they'll never find. Talk about the old ways, before the Spanish and the smallpox, and the price they paid. Before the Spanish and the smallpox, and the price they paid. And a golden spruce grew tall, and the maybe one day it'll rise again. Okay. We're going to do a song called Cold Road right now. And it was written a couple springs ago. And actually, I grew up, played hockey outside because we weren't allowed in the house. hockey was a big part of a lot of people's lives. And a couple years ago in the spring, the Humboldt Broncos bus had a big accident, and a lot of kids were hurt, and it really touched. There were multiple deaths, and it touched a lot of us right across the country, because we've all been on those buses and put our kids on them and stuff like that. And so, yeah, this song's called Cold Road, and I actually got a letter from a guy who played a lot of junior hockey when he heard this song, and he really liked it. And here you go. 2, 3, 4. I got two sticks in an old photo. That's all that's left of the dream. I remember how good it felt to call you up and tell you that I made the team. All the early morning practices on the ice at 5 a.m. We'd laugh and swear we better get this right so we never have to do it again. And it's over and over and over till you don't think about it anymore. If you get it, it might open the door. This cold road calls. It's a road of hope. This cold road calls. It's a road of dreams. Another frozen highway. This cold road calls. Try to catch a little sleep on the bus. Get ready for the next big test. And some of us talk quietly. Who's the fastest? Who's the best? That new kid's already a friend. A month ago, I never even knew his name. The old trainer tells me he's got a little magic in his game. In the summer, we talk about winter. Hey, where you gonna be next fall? You say I'm 18. If I don't make it this year, I'm worth nothing at all. This cold road calls. It's a road of hope. And this cold road calls. It's a road of dreams. Another frozen highway. This cold road calls. It's the 6th of April, and I'm numb. Right across this country, we're a little shaken from coast to coast. This is how we live, and it's who we are. Pass a bus out on the highway, some kids off to another game. This is how we live, and it's who we are. And frozen parking lots warming up our cars. It's how we live. And it's who we are. This cold road calls. It's a road of hope. And this cold road calls. It's a road of dreams. Another frozen highway. This cold road calls. Another frozen highway. This cold road calls. This cold road. Okay, so do a song called This Town. It's actually, you know, it's hard to believe how much civilization has evolved in Canada, anyways. but I feel very, very fortunate. I don't have high-speed internet or anything where I live, but maybe one day. But we got power, so we're doing pretty good. But incredible, how much growth, and we've learned a lot about each other. We've made lots of mistakes too, but hopefully, as a country, we'll learn to adjust as human beings. Sometimes we adapt. Hope so. Anyways, the song's called "This Town," and it's about the spirit of the community, and you believe in the people you're with, and a community, and really cool things can happen. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4. My Uncle Ernie, he moved here from Winnipeg 70 years ago. He said, sometimes you gotta take a chance in life, hey, you never know. Wrote a letter to his sister in Toronto and said, everything is gonna be just fine. Packed everything he owned and headed west on the Grand Trunk Railroad line. Every day he rode the winding tracks up and down till the conductor stared at some mud and tents and said, here's your town now. This town will be built on the backs of the people who live here in this town. Will be built on the backs of the people who die here in this town. And might just disappear, but this town could live on. From the open ditches and the wooden sidewalks, the first big hotel. Another stranger off the train, another story to tell. And a brand new railway station at the end of the street. Every town needed an important place for people to meet. And Ernie sent his two boys off to fight Adolf Hitler. And all he could think to say was, hurry back home now. This town will be built on the backs of the people who live here in this town. Will be built on the backs of the people who die in this town. It'll never disappear, in this town will live on. Now there's no talk of unlimited timber around here anymore. And it's harder to find a good paying job than it ever was before. But the right people came and the right people stayed. And in the hard times, they would not be swayed. And I'm still quoting Ernie, though he's buried on the hill. He said so many things could happen if you only have the will. Now this town will be built on the backs of the people who live here in this town. Will be built on the backs of the people who die here in this town. Will never disappear, but this town will live on. Yeah, this town will be built on the backs of the people who live here in this town. Will be built on the backs of the people who die here in this town. Will never disappear, but this town will live on. You know, the town is the people and the people are the town. Either town is the people and the people are the town. Either town is the people and the people are the town. Yeah, town is the people and the people are the town.
Ondimie kulusu, opesinga ibomoy, okomi na voka na ngai. I go bless you, daddy. Oh, daddy, oh, daddy, oh, thank you, daddy. Daddy, oh, daddy, oh, merci, oh.
Jehovah, tolo dio.
Mama,
libella. Joe, we lift an empire.
Mama, libella. So this first set is called Canadian Sunshine, and the first tune is a French air from Quebec, and the second tune is actually a Scottish reel, but not really a reel because it's a very crooked tune. But the first bit is Canadian, and the second bit I learned from a Scottish band is Holland.
Introductions to fiddling through the Value Fiddlers. Value Fiddlers has always like played music from all sorts of different places. And we often have mentors come up from across Canada and other places as well. This next piece that we're going to play is it's kind of like a klezmer Eastern European gypsy piece. But it's actually written by a Canadian fiddler, Gordon Stobie. He's from Halifax, and he came up and taught this to the youth fiddlers a while ago. It's a really fun piece.
Thank you.
So this next one is taught to our, it's called Purple Hymn, and beneath the ice they heard bells. So it's two tunes. And it was taught to us by one of our mentors, one of the mentors that is like very, very, very near and dear to mine and Kiri's hearts, especially. His name is Oliver Shore. And he was a huge part of the fiddle community in Smithers for years and years and years and years, until he, unfortunately, he passed away 12 years ago now. It's insane, but it's really, really beautiful that we still play his music. And there's so many people in Smithers that still love him and play his music. So this is one of our favorites. Thank you.
This next piece is, actually, you should do this one. You know more about it than I do.
Sure. So when I was very, very young, I got obsessed with Riverdance, which if you don't know what it is, you should. It's like Irish step dancing, but just at an ultimate level. And my parents are just like Celtic crazy people. So they just fed me Riverdance from like age 4, and now I'm 24 and I'm obsessed, still obsessed. So this tune is actually the finale from their show. So it's called Heartland, and it's by Bill Whelan. So it's very, very Irish. Just very Irish, but like kind of a crooked Irish tune. Not traditional at all.
Actually, I'm just gonna cheat.
Peace be upon you, everybody. My name is Suad. I'm from Tunisia, North Africa. I've been here in Canada since 2014, and I'm here to tell a story about the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, last messenger for all creation, from childhood and until he met Jibreel, angel of God. Abdul Muttalib has 10 sons. Between them was one, his name Abdullah. He married in a woman from city of Quraysh, the noble and very rich lady. And she get pregnant with Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. During her pregnancy, her husband died. She gave birth in 12 Rabi al-Awwal, year of elephant, 571 AD, in city of Mecca. It was the happiest day, the sun rise and everything light up on the earth. The kings were astonished. The grandfather named him Muhammad. His mother didn't have milk to feed him, so she started looking for a lady to feed him. All lady was there, they doesn't want to help him because he was orphaned. So there are a lady there, she poor, and her name Halima Sadia. She just took him to her home. And when she took him, God sent blessing and she just turned rich and wealthy. During he living there, God sent an angel to clean his heart and he for become purity. Halima returned him to his mother and grandfather in Mecca after 2 years. He lived with them happy, and his mother died during the traveling to between Mecca and Medina, and he was 6 years old. His grandfather took him and take care for him. Until 8 years old, his grandfather died too. Then his uncle, Abu Talib, take care for him. He was loving him, take care for him, and he was so compassionate for him because he orphaned. He grew up kind and lovely. Everybody love everybody, respect everybody. Muhammad, peace be upon him, was saved by God Almighty and stayed away from ignorance, bad habits, worshipping idols, drinking, and other bad things, other sins. Muhammad, peace be upon him, grew up pure and kind, humble and shy, and respect of everyone because of his honesty and purity. People nickname him honest and faithful. He was always good and kind to his family, honest for his guests, helping poor people, respect everyone, always did right and fair things. He worked hard herding sheep and was also to merchant. He was faithful and blessed. He got married in age 25 with a lady called Khadija bint Khuwailid. May God bless her. One day when he turned 40 years old, he felt he liked to be alone. So he walked far away from where he living until he can't see any houses or anything, until he gets in a cave called Cave Hora. This in a mountain in Nur, in Mecca. So he go there and try to praying. He knows God, of course, but at the time. So he praying. Then God sent Gabriel to him to tell him, you will be last messenger for all human beings. After that, he became a prophet to unite all people. That's why we love him and respect him, because he freedom slaves and freedom women. He said to men to respect their women, to be kind to women and all human beings. He be humble and respect others even if they are different. We all brother and sister. He said, no one is better than someone else except those who are close to God.